Hello and welcome back to Black on Couch Reviews. I'm your host, Christina. We are back for a new series, The Stranger on Netflix, that has been in my queue for, a few years. I've been wanting to check out this show and it's just been patiently awaiting its turn. So let's go ahead and begin by taking a peek behind the curtains. So The Stranger is a 8-part miniseries created by Harlan Coben based on The Stranger that he also wrote. However, the series is written by an array of other folks, Danny Brocklehurst, Mick Ford, and Carla Chrome. Why do I know that name? Did she play in Misfits? Holy shit, she was just in Misfits. That's good to know. I didn't know she was quite the writer. Oh, look, she's got a lot of writing credits. That's good for her. So this series was directed by Daniel O'Hara and Hannah Quinn. Our cast is Richard Armitage as Adam Price. He was in the third or fourth season of Hannibal, which was my favorite season of Hannibal, mainly because I like the Red Dragon story. Siobhan Finnerman as Detective Sergeant or DS Johanna Griffin. Jennifer Saunders as Heidi Doyle. Sean Dooley as Doug Tripp. He was also in Misfits. Paul Kay as Patrick Katz. I don't think we've met him. At least I don't believe so. Dervla Kirwan as Corinne Price. Kadeef Kirwan as D.S. Wesley Ross. Jacob Dudman as Thomas Price. Ella Ray Smith as Daisy Hoy. I think she's just been recently cast in the second season of Foundation, if I am not mistaken. Misha Hanley as Ryan Price. Anthony Head as Edgar Price. Hannah John Kamen? Kamen? I'm not quite sure. As The Stranger, and Steven Rea as Martin Killane. There is a long list of recurring and guest stars as well. The opening theme, Monster, is by Walking on Cars, composer David Buckley. And I think we've given credit where credit is due, well, with the exception of producer Madonna Baptiste. So now let's get into the episode. I didn't rely on any notes for this first episode, which is just episode one, which was written by Danny Brocklehurst and directed by Daniel O'Hara. I gave it an 8.6 out of 10. There seems to be two mysteries going on. The first one being, who is the stranger? Why now has she dropped this information that has led to a rift in the Price's marriage? And then there's the bonfire party that has left someone on life support with a brain injury and a alcapult. I don't even know what that is. I don't even know if I'm saying it right. But it is decapitated and left for the police to find. So there's something going on that happened at this party that involves the younger set. So I like that they kind of split it into an adult mystery and a teen mystery. We start with Adam Price. I'm just going to go by memory. him taking his son Ryan to a football match, which is soccer in England. And like all men, they never read the note on the refrigerator that's trying to organize their life so they don't forget that this particular match is fathers versus the children. He also is trying to get on the A-team, and his brother is giving a whole bunch of shit about it. That is, of course, what siblings are supposed to do. He was not prepared at all. He didn't have nothing on. And he also really sucked as a goalie. Is that what they're called? Yeah, a goalie. Letting them kids whoop his ass.
You know, I'm getting real tired of this, Luigi.
He gets a call from his wife, Corinne. They seem to have a happy marriage. She's at a conference. And while she's there, she's having a good time. He sees the stranger below him. And when he comes back inside, she approaches him and kind of gives him this ponderous look before deciding to ruin his life with some information. It being, hey, so your wife's most recent pregnancy and miscarriage, she absolutely and utterly faked that shit. And you might want to get your kids' DNA tested.
Who the fuck are you, man?
She tells him, look, I'm just a friend. He chases her out. She leaves. She got a blonde woman in the car with her. But he's able to take a photo of her license plate. He, of course, wants to brush this aside. But he immediately calls his wife when he gets home, like, I have questions. She also tells him if he needs proof, all you gotta do is look at your receipt. And you'll see that she went to this funsy place that helped fake her pregnancy. The thing I don't get about British folks is they really be letting their children bring home people. Just, they spent the night. Does your parents know? You just take their word for it? Y'all some trustworthy motherfuckers. I will never, ever, ever, ever let a boy into my child's room. And they up there kissing too. They doing the exact thing. You ain't even trying to check in on them. See what they up to. He even left. I mean, they do things differently across the pond. But I was like, wow. And then they left the home. And he seemed to have no problems with checking on, making sure they was actually in their bed that night when he got back. That was so much. So very much. It's going to be hard as hell for my child to sneak out. Hard as hell. He then gets a call from Martin, which is one of his clients. He really locked another lawyer or somewhere from the property. It looks like they're buying. They've bought out everyone in this neighborhood. And he's the last one that does not want to move and will not accept any offer. But the guy from the company is kind of like, look, I'm authorized to go up to $400,000. Why doesn't he just take the offer? Because that would be much better than holding out. And you know that your client is not going to win this, even if they want to keep fighting it. So at least take the money. He then comes back home, goes through some photos of when his kid was a child, but something's not lining up about them baby pictures, which makes him go online and decide to look at his bank statements. And lo and behold, there is a transaction for the name of the company that she told him.
What? What the fuck?
Sticking with the Price marriage, he's not happy about this. He also is having flashbacks to when it seemed like things were not kosher. You know, it looked like he thought one time maybe he saw a fake baby bump. She never wanted to have sex. He never saw her naked. He didn't go to any ultrasounds. And she seemed to be very far along, like 6 to 7 months pregnant. That is a long time to be telling such a long con. And I think if he would have just listened, he would have heard why she did it. Because I think I know I could put it together very easily. And I ain't why I have not seen anything besides the trailer. And even that I don't remember. I just know that I really like the actress, Hannah Joel. Last name, Hannah John came in. And thus, I wanted to always check the show out. And I heard that it was really good. And usually British TV miniseries are. So here we are. I just realized, no, he did not leave the house that night. He actually left that morning. And that's when he said, oh, she spent the night. Or that's when the daughter, no, that was the next morning. But they really just think that, like, yo, is she over here? What do you mean is she? You don't, how you not know where your child is? Y'all need to know where y'all babies are. Just don't. Or call the adults to double check that the people are there that are saying that's where they're going. That's how you get caught. That's the number one rule, man. I don't know how y'all don't know that. So back to Karan getting back early from the vacation. He pulls up to see her and he's not too happy about it. Especially since the bank just called him and said, look, there is some bogus companies that this company leads to. I can send you their IP addresses and an email, but that's all we got for you. She's like, what the fuck? Why aren't you happy to see me? And he's like, no, I am. Just stressed out about work.
Liar, whore, and you know it.
As soon as he can get a moment alone, he's on the laptop checking them IP addresses. One is to a fake injury. One is to a fake... I don't even know what that one, the last one was for. But it definitely leads to a fake pregnancy with all the accessories you would need to pull off this pregnancy. Did he need to look at the testimonial? I wanted to have a surrogate. It's kind of like, yeah, there's people who use this for legit reasons. And then there's also people who do this for deceptive reasons. He decides to just chat with her about it. And I would say that's very mature, because I would think that other people would hold on to it, you know, mull on it for a long time. He goes straight to it. I need to talk to you outside in that gorgeous ass garden. I need a garden that looks exactly like that. And he's like, look, did you fake your pregnancy?
What did he say?
She is a terrible liar. Her mouth just kept flopping open. He's like, okay, so tell me what this is. What do you mean? I'm not going to answer the question. I'm just going to keep dodging. Who told you this? Why would you think I faked my pregnancy? I'm not asking you. I'm telling you. I have proof. Then why are you asking? Clearly, you don't believe what you see, so you want her to explain it to you. You practically yell it at her.
Explain to me!
She starts to talk about this friend who lost a baby. It was stillborn. But then she came back and saw her a few weeks later. And it looked like she was heavily pregnant still. She was surrounded by other mothers. And, you know, she felt special. She felt loved and comforted. And he's like, what the fuck does this have to do with you faking your pregnancy? And also, is my children mine? She's like, of course they're your children. But also, I have no explanation for why I really faked my pregnancy. It wasn't until later, because he is mad at her. They don't talk about it. Ryan's like, are you okay, mom? Everything's fine. He sleeps in the guest bedroom. That morning, he sees her yelling at someone on the phone, and she had left him with the words, it's more than you think. And then when she comes in to talk to him, he's like, the worst thing about this, because she's like, look, let's just have a conversation after we do the award ceremony. We'll talk it out, and then we'll figure out what we want to do after that. And then because he's feeling like he has a moral ground to stand on in this moment, which it feels like he does, but I'm just throwing it out there. He definitely cheated, right? Because she says, or when he's like, I don't trust you anymore. That's the worst part of it. And she's like, yeah, it sucks, doesn't it? It hurts, doesn't it? That's what she says. And he looks at her confusingly, and she's like, we all have our secrets, don't we, Adam? And as soon as she said that, I was like, oh, this is her response to his cheating. I, of course, can have egg all over my face if my supposition is wrong and my cynical side of life just takes over. But that's what that read like to me. coupled with what she was trying to tell him earlier, like, I felt a certain loss and this helped me psychologically get through that. It's not healthy. It's definitely deceptive and manipulative, but clearly she's embarrassed of what she did. Then again, she just could be embarrassed that she got caught out there. But that's what women typically do when they try want to keep their marriage, right? They either get knocked up or you pretend to get knocked up. And that's unfortunate that women feel the need to do such things when men go out and fucking put their dick in another woman, because they take it all the way into their self-esteem versus putting the blame on the male who could not commit to a woman that is committed to them, because they need to feel secure in their own selves. Like, them cheating, all they want to do is have their cake and eat it too. They want to go out there and proliferate. They want to spread their seed. Go to the Jones Chronicles for more ideas on male monogamy. Well, monogamy in period in general. But this ends or wraps up when he goes to the ceremony. She is elected as Teacher of the Year, but she's not there. She hasn't shown up. He's concerned. He barks at his kid, like, do you know where the fuck she is? Then shut the hell up. But he's trying to calm them also, like, don't be worried. Your mom's just not feeling well. They hope she's going to be home, but I don't think, yeah, they did get home. She wasn't there. Then later on, Adam gets a text where she says, look, I just need some time. Give me a few days. And that's the kind of end of their particular story arc. Let's go to this, what is it called? Alpaca. So there's a decapitated alpaca in the middle of town. We meet our DS's, Wes and Johanna. Wes is younger, he's gay, he's a tweeter. He tries to take photos of a crime scene, which I'm told is illegal, but it is an animal, so maybe not so much. Johanna is going through a split with her husband, even though they live in the same home. He's in the guest bedroom snoring up a storm. That would drive me up a wall.
I'm just gonna hurt you. Really, really bad.
I am not a snorer. I know I can't hear myself, but I've been told I not only do not move a lot, I sleep like the dead. I'm like, that must be when I'm asleep, because I flip and flop all damn night. After 26 years of marriage, she's done. She wants to end it. Her and her friend Heidi want to go on a vacation to the States, like Thelma and Louise, because she's also at the cusp of retiring. So she gets this particular case, and it leads to, on the way back to the precinct, Wes discovering some discarded clothes. They follow the trail, and it leads to an unconscious Dante, who was at that bonfire last night. That morning, because Adam was too concerned about his own life and his marriage, he didn't notice that his child, Thomas, was acting weird. That one boy is eating pancakes without syrup, which I don't understand. My daughter does the same thing. And he tells his friend, like, we gotta go now. What's up with that? We also know his girlfriend, Daisy, was yelling at Dante at the party. And there's something going on with Ella, her younger sister, because Vicky shows up like, hey, can you watch my daughter? I got shit to do. Just for an hour. But later on, we see her in the bathroom. She's crying and looking at her phone. So what's going on with that? Is it connected? She said her daughter's been depressed for some time. So get her some help. Go send her to some counseling. I can understand you think maybe they're going through a phase. You don't jump to the counseling stage. But if it goes on for more than a week or so, because kids usually bounce back. Anytime they're in a depressive funk for some time, then you gotta figure out what's going on. You gotta try a little bit harder, even if it's not to you. And then there was a parent that went up to Vicky at the school, like, hey, your daughter and Mia used to be friends, but they're not talking anymore. Something's going on. And then her daughter Ella's looking directly at her, like, yeah, I'm definitely, y'all know y'all talking about me. And she runs off, so Vicky chases her. Later on in the hospital, that's when we find out that he has a significant brain injury. They also realize that a human person bit into the animal's leg. And when they get to the precinct, the results come back and it is not Dante. Someone else was involved that is missing one of their molars. I don't know why I automatically thought of the one friend, but I did. And I know it had nothing to do with anything other than the fact that he looked like he was tripping balls. But he kept flashing back to that party. At the end of the episode, I'm not sure why, if you already know what's in that trash bag, that you need to show it, present it in that particular fashion, but it's TV. And we find out that our young Thomas has the head of the Apaka. So he definitely was involved. There's shenanigans all over this town. I like that. That's what I love about British television series. They know how to come with the mystery. And while it's not always successful, more often than not, it is. It's entertaining. They did go to the farmer to ask about if she had one of her alpacas missing. And she named them all. She's like, Niall. I don't know why my voice is so scratchy. It just is. I think it's the weather because it keeps changing every 5 seconds. So what is Daisy hiding? What is Ella hiding? What is Dante hiding? Because he was just butt-ass naked out there. And you ain't going down, like, he made a very valid point. You're going to go really slow. Like, you do dumb things when you're a child, but you also ain't that dumb. And he would have slowed down in the dark knowing that big decline was coming. So, feels like foul play. Also, where is Corinne? Who is she talking to? Where is she at? What's she doing? We end the episode with Johanna's friend, Heidi, locking up her shop, and across the street is the stranger.
This girl is on fire!
And that is how we end our episode, our little adventure. If you want to join in our discussion regarding the second episode, you can send all feedback to blackercouch@gmail.com. You can leave a comment below on this podcast. My social media will be there as well. Remember to like, share, and subscribe. Until the next time, peace, hair grease, and blacker magic.